Okay, let's go ahead and call the December meeting to order. Do a roll call. Let's see, are you noting who's here?
Yeah, I noted.
Yeah. Good.
Six present.
Okay, so moving on to approving the agenda, we have a motion to approve.
I move to approve the agenda.
Second.
Thank you. Any discussions, any changes? All in favor of approving the agenda, say aye.
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 Opposed? Okay. Moving on to announcements. Tracy, over to you.
I don't really have anything other than the burn went good. I think I sent you guys some info on that.
Yeah.
It went good. Everybody was very happy with the results and we didn't have any issues, so that was a good, it was a lot of work, but it was something that I'm definitely gonna think about doing again because it really worked out well and Chris is happy with the results and
great.
Alright.
The new little natives are coming up, the little grasses.
Uh-huh.
But other than that, I don't have any other announcements. Hi.
Okay. Other commissioners' announcements? Okay. I don't either, so we can go ahead and move on to public comment.
Roads Commission is the question.
Are you looking for open space?
I think so. Sometimes the calendar gets a little overwhelmed.
I don't know where I am.
Okay, seeing, well, do you have any announcements or here just?
I do not have any announcements.
Good, so we'll move on to the consent calendar. We have a motion to approve the consent calendar, which consists of the minutes from last month.
I saw a couple errors in there.
Okay.
Okay.
One was the motion for the South Fork was me, not Sarah.
Oh, yeah, I missed that too.
And the.
Wait, where?
There's a motion.
Motion for the South Fork.
Because we have two SGs now.
Oh, I.
I just am realizing, because I took my little note, so you're both an SG, so you're gonna have to be S Ger. You'll be SG. So, yeah, that's why.
Okay.
Okay.
Don't get grumpy about it.
For South Fork?
You guys cornered me and made me do that.
Wait, you want the cream?
Wait, for which one?
South Fork.
Because I have Commissioner Guncey and made the joint motion.
Bye-bye.
Yeah, it was him, not me.
Oh, it was you?
Yeah.
Okay, got it, alright.
Well, it was S-Ger.
So, okay, the other SG. Okay, alrighty, got that. Anything else?
The meeting, next meeting date was not the 4th, but the 2nd.
Oh, okay, yes. Got that too.
Little stuff, but I'm trained at very minor details.
No, that's fine, okay. I'm happy with that. So now I know about the SGs.
Alright, anyone else?
No.
Do we have a motion to approve with the noted corrections?
Yes. Move to accept the.
S-Gers.
S-Ger.
Do you have a second?
Second.
Thank you. Any more discussion on that? All in favor of passing consent calendars, say aye.
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 Opposed? Okay. Good, moving right along. Over to, we have two main items tonight, both discussion items on budget and the strategic plan. So Tracy, I will hand it over to you.
Yeah, so this is a little late in the year to be doing this, but better late than never, I suppose. Some of you haven't kind of gone through this before. I just thought I made some copies in case people, I made some hard copies in case people wanted a hard copy, but if you need another, I can work off the screen if somebody needs another one. I didn't make a ton of copies. So, anyway, I don't have to go through, I'm not going to go through everything because that would take a long time, and hopefully everybody sort of reviewed it, and I'm happy to answer questions about it. I'll sort of keep it at a high level and kind of hit, kind of for some that are kind of new at the commission, I'll kind of hit sort of the important points, but I won't go into it all unless, and but if you have questions about anything, just let me know. So kind of how I usually do this is I kind of just do a brief little summary of the past year, and then we look forward a year. Some of this, the way I do this is really because I post it on the website, so it's kind of done in a way that, like, for example, all the accomplishments and things like that, it's more for the public. If somebody clicks on it and just gets an idea of what's going on, so we don't have to go through all those. But I try to just sort of keep it somewhat, you know, easy to digest for people, you know, if they want just a snapshot. So so last year, so basically, just so for people who are new, you know, our the open space budget right now, you know, I would say, you know, about $485,000 we need just to maintain status quo stuff. Like, that's just for the staffing costs, the overhead, the general, like, the regular supplies that we get every year, you know, just sort of the operating, the baseline operating costs. So that's kind of just, you know, a number to keep in mind. So when the budget's more than that, it usually, that's usually the additional things that we do, the projects, you know. So it could be, you know, like, either it could be one of our acquisitions of land or easements. It could be one of our capital improvements if we did a habitat restoration, you know, or if we have a special project like an invasive species removal. So those are like extras that get added on, but like the baseline, I always kind of think of it as like just what we need if we really, you know, had to totally, you know, trim back. We need about $450,000 to just kind of keep things going. And so you can see last year kind of how that plays out on the budget in terms of what was in the budget. Now, we didn't spend all this money because obviously we didn't purchase the El Molino Farm conservation easement. We, you know, haven't spent all the $570,000 on the wetlands habitat restoration project yet, or the signage project. So some of these things were, this budget also was sort of a two-year budget that the city does. Mm. So these things were budgeted, but not necessarily spent, right? Mm. So some of that money that's listed there, you know, we still have. So you can see on the revenue sources, you know, this program heavily relies. Oh, I'm sorry.
Yeah.
I forgot about it. I apologize.
Hold on the paper.
Sure. So go to next.
Keep going. Yeah.
So yeah, that's what I was just talking about. How so you can see the baseline budget was like about $476,000, and then we had these other add-ons that increased. The budget was quite large last year because we had these two acquisitions. And that's the other thing, is that in the budget, I also like put the, so if there's a, for example, on the El Molino or the Gill, well, actually El Molino is different, Gill, we were accepting the grant, so I had to put that in the budget too. So we didn't, the city didn't spend $1.26 million on the Gill Orchard easement because that line item included all the grant funds that we got. So I have to put that in the budget too, because then when the check shows up, you know, hey, what is this, you know, it has to be accounted for in the budget. So that's why it might look like, whoa, we were going to spend a lot of money, but for Gill that included the grant. Now El Molino, that is what we were budgeted to put in because we were not accepting the grant. That was sort of done differently because the Solano Land Trust was the one that did the grant application. We didn't. So, and that easement is a lot more expensive because he subdivided his property, so that one was budgeted a lot, and I still have that money, because obviously we haven't bought that one yet, hasn't closed yet. So that's just, I mean, I guess in there, the one, the Gill is really the one that sort of has, that one has the grant funds in it, that just, that reminds me then. Yeah, so, go ahead, sorry, go ahead.
So question, then whatever the state grant then shows in the revenue sources, is that how you balance the thing?
Yeah, so if you go to the next slide, so that, those are the, so then the revenue source is to sort of cover that 3.8 that was in the budget.
Mm-hmm.
So you can see there was, the state grant is sort of the gray color, so that's 24% was the state grant that came on Gill 2.
And can you explain a little more about the impact fees? I don't really know how those work.
So, so the open space development impact, so I was gonna say two of the key kind of funding sources for this program are Measure O, which we've talked about a lot, parcel tax, and then the other one is the open space development impact fees. So what those are basically when a new development gets built. So let's just say Mace Ranch. And as part of that development, the developer has to pay a bunch of different impact fees because all those new people are gonna have impacts to schools, to parks, to open space, you know, to the existing city services and infrastructure, right? So the concept is, you know, they're gonna contribute something and then those funds then are restricted to improving whatever that is for this larger now population, right? So they can't really be used for maintenance. They can be used for acquisitions or capital improvements, things that are improving or expanding and, you know, preserve things like that, but not for just our general maintenance stuff. So
and are these one-time hits or is this annual? Just this year we happen to have this big chunk of...
No, so they go into this fund, Fund 42. So I don't even know, like those funds...
So we anticipate this about the same amount of money from there every year?
No, it depends on the it depends on the number and size of the development that's happening in the city. So it fluctuates a lot.
Mm-hmm.
They also... technically, as I'm learning, have kind of, they don't go away, but you kind of have, you're supposed to use them within a certain period of time.
Mm-hmm.
And that's one of the reasons why a lot of these acquisitions and whatnot, like originally I was thinking, oh, I'd use Measure O, Measure O. But the city really wants to use, I am using some Measure O, but we have to use these open space development.
All day may use it.
We're using kind of more of those, like for example, the wetlands habitat restoration, that entire contract for the designer for the habitat was all open space development impact fees. Because
surprised to see that, which is where some of these questions are coming from.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
So
the construction is going to be Measure Up.
Okay. To get a sense of the timeline, so this 47% of the budget that's impact fees now, which... development or developments is that from? Do we know?
No, I don't know.
Is it
past?
I know, but I'm just trying to figure out: is it
but
Cannery past? Is it Nishi? Is it Bretton Woods?
What's the lag?
Yeah.
Well, you know, that's a good question. I don't know. There are other draws on the open. There are some other things that it gets spent on. Because it can be some for community. I don't know. I'm not even sure we know, like, when a dollar goes into that fund, if we track it and we can, like, connect it to a particular development
project. But there is a time, like, a deadline.
There is.
Finance,
you know, I mean, we've had some of these. Nobody's really lodged a protest.
Mm-hmm.
But finance has kind of made it clear to me, hey, we really got to start trimming down this fund a bit. you know, because it just got too large. Because on, you know, I think on here, when I looked at the, so we still have 1.2 in there. She just wants to get it down further than that. So that's one of the reasons why I've been spending more of those funds than Measure O.
And another question is that it's separate from the ag buffers or the development, and it's separate from their 2-to-1 or whatever where they have to.
Yes, it's totally separate from that.
It's still on top of all that, right?
Yeah. So like when you ever, if you ever, you know, like we're going to get some development projects coming through here shortly. You know, one of the things, the big thing that's negotiated is the development agreement. And you'll always see there's a particular exhibit that has all the impact fees, you know, listed out that the developer is paying for. Sometimes they're even, they can be transportation related. Some of them, I'm not exactly sure. Some of them are like state requirements. I'm not exactly sure what requires them, but they're always in there. And they're restricted, so they can't be used for other things. So like for example, the signage project, I've been trying to, you know, use these impact fees as much as I can. So like on that, the open space signage project mostly was the impact fees as well. Although I've mentioned, you know, on the easements in particular, you know, I'm happy to use some, but I don't want to use all because I want to have Measure O. I want the map to show that Measure O was used. So on the easements, I'm you know, pretty adamant with finance that, hey, you know, I just don't want it to be 100%. You know, you got to put some Measure O in there. So we do that on the acquisitions.
Yeah. And that's mostly for optics, like to show that it's being...
For acquisition, because that's more like, yeah, it's a visual. If I have a map showing like, okay, here are the easements where Measure O has contributed to around the city, you know. Whereas like the signage project, nobody's going to really care about that as much, right? So visually, I think it'll make more, because that's what, you know, that was a big purpose of Measure O was to acquire open space from the city. So, are there any other questions about that?
Just to clarify, the impact fees is meaning that not that they are impacting open space, but that the additional development will provide a strain or like a need for more, whatever, maybe it's housing, more residents to use open space.
Right, it'd be an impact on the existing open space. Okay. More people using the same resources.
Right.
Yeah, exactly.
Whereas the ag mitigation is if they're actually taking some piece of ag land, right?
Okay. Yes, the ag in lieu. Do I have those in here? Sometimes I've had ag in lieu fees, but I think those are all gone now because we used it a long time ago. Use that, accept in lieu fees instead of land. We still do accept that, but it's a lot harder to do that now. So we had some old like in lieu fees, but I think I pretty much used those. There's a few left, I think, on that list. There's like 200,000 or something, small number. But those are old too. Those are very old from some old development project that paid an in lieu fee instead of donating an easement.
Got it.
Are there any other questions about the 23, the old last year's budget summary?
There's just one more question about the impact fee restrictions. Is it actually explicit to capital improvements? Or, I mean, I think even looking at some of what is tagged like operations and maintenance, I think could argue. Some of those expenses could go in, could be considered capital improvement to the open space or to like the web services aspect of the program, so I was curious to, I mean, maybe it's not something to resolve here, but that'd be something to explore.
Well, I mean, I've been told by finance and the city attorney's office that, you know, that they can't really be used to just sort of, yeah, they could, if I wanted to do, say, expand, you know, expand a trail or do something right. like something that's a capital improvement, but I can't, but it can't be used just for our regular like operating yeah. budget right. to maintain what we have.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, just yes. something to potentially consider when I know we're going to go to the strategic plan, but thinking about, because I was trying to look at some of those actions and like, well, yeah. some of these could be considered like reframed to fit that
fit,
line
possibly.
Component.
Well, like the signs were for sure.
Signs. Certainly in the trails, even some of the, like you could create a project out of some of the maintaining hedgerows, you know, but actually make them more of a discrete project around. So anyway, just
yeah.
thoughts to consider if you're.
I mean, it's always, I can always try, you know, if I can't, you yeah. know. Usually so, finance is the
or,
one that
or like the benches or mm-hmm. like are there more of those that mm-hmm. could consider like some of them that said done that are mm-hmm. or maybe it's there is this pot of funding to consider.
So just to clarify for myself, you're suggesting that we somehow try to use as a capital improvement instead of a maintenance category? You're kind of shifting categories to get what we need.
Just something to consider if you, I mean, I think my overall, we can get to it later. Yeah, if there's a need, but just trying to understand the.
I think it's
the,
a great idea.
The spending
like, how
plan
do we do that?
For the remaining funds. So we'll let Tracy get to that of like what the goals are, you know, targeted milestones.
Good.
Okay, anything else?
I was looking at this earlier, I remembered seeing something about interpretive signs, and there's the, under the goal, let's see, public access and recreation, PAR, whatever that means, increased availability of passive recreational improvements, i.e. interpretive panels, so on, seating areas, signage, that kind of thing. It seems like what Lindsay was saying is related to that
yes.
objective. And it seems like we could sort of mix those categories a little bit.
Yeah, and I'm
and
I did
through
use,
the general plan.
Yes, I mean I did use open space development impact fees to do the big, you know, $300,000 signage for all the medallions, mm-hmm. all the site signs, all of that. I for the North Davis Habitat. Mm-hmm. The little interpretive panels. I wanted Measure O to pay for that because
mm-hmm. Yeah, that would be good.
Because
yeah,
Measure O paid because I just wanted Measure O to show it was the only habitat mm-hmm. restoration that was within the city limits, mm-hmm. a big one that
yeah,
Measure
good.
O funded, and so I wanted Measure yeah. O to pay for those signs.
Yeah,
but
I think to that point. I was just saying, oh, if there's additional funds, maybe we can do more around,
yeah,
instead
exactly.
of like saying, oh, we're done in some
yeah.
of those categories. If it's like interpretive signs are putting in for Measure O, but maybe there's an opportunity for a bench or something.
Sure.
Like that. So just a way to.
Yeah. We can talk because, I don't think I said done on the signage, but I don't know what you're referring to, but we can totally talk about that.
Yeah.
For sure.
Cool.
It's progress. Or
yeah.
this particular one, it's progress.
I mean, believe me, I'm always
but, like, one thing
using
that,
dollars.
One thing I've learned about
dollars.
One thing I've learned about interpretive signs, they last like 5 years max, and then you have to replace them.
Mm.
So I don't think they're ever done.
No, they're not.
Benches too. They tend to.
Yeah, although
they're a little
more
honestly, durable.
We don't really like benches.
They don't want to do that. Okay.
Well, I mean, Chris, we have like more natural seating things, like either rocks or logs or things like that. But we do a bench, and it starts becoming a problem. Camping.
Mm.
It just is having a big bench. I don't know.
Okay.
we have problems with benches in the open space areas.
Attracts uses that we don't really want.
Yeah, I mean, Wild Horse, in the Wild Horse Ag Buffer, they're okay, but even there, but because there's so many people. But that's one reason why we don't do them at South Fork Preserve.
Yeah, that makes sense.
Anyway, that's a, it's more of like a maintenance, vandalism, land management issue sometimes when we.
Okay.
Benches. Okay, so then this next year, we'll go to the next one.
2024-25.
Oh, I wasn't right.
Yeah.
No,
no. One more.
So then, one of the things that we've been, since about, I started in 2015, and when I, this is for the new commissioners, when I got here, there was a lot of, there were some community members that were upset with how much of the, so about 700,000 every year comes in for Measure O, 700,000 a year, about. And they were upset that over 50% of it at that time was going towards staff and just maintenance and not to acquisitions and capital improvements, right? And so at that time, so we did this whole big analysis, I won't go into it, but it was a couple of years long. And we had a few, workshops in front of the city council. And one of the things, as staff, I sort of informally pledged, it's not really written anywhere, but except in staff reports, informally pledged to say, hey, we're going to try to keep that number down to about a third. Mm-hmm. So over the years since then, I've been trying to keep it to 33% or so of, again, what would comes in annually, not the percent of expenses, but what comes in annually, a third of it, not more than a third. So that two thirds then is quote unquote saved for acquisitions or capital improvements or whatever we want to do. So I've been able to maintain that. This year we went over a little bit because, as everyone I'm sure knows, costs have gone up everywhere.
Mm-hmm.
Costs have really gone up just for everything. And so we're a little bit over. We're 35% this year instead of 33%. So, I'm going to keep an eye on that. Some of that, there's not a lot I can do about. It's the cost of... the only thing I could potentially do is try to lower the percentage of I'll get to that later, but... My only a percentage of my position is paid with Measure O, and a percentage of Chris's position, I could lower those amount. But again, if I do that, then it goes to the general fund.
Mm-hmm.
So, a lot of people aren't happy about that either. So, so we just try to keep it. The thing is too, the number, the revenue number coming in doesn't really go up from year to year.
Mm-hmm.
Because number one, the assessment is fixed for the entire time. It doesn't even go up by inflation.
Mm-hmm.
So that's another kind of pressure on it. Even if I maintain exactly what I have, there's a chance that we will go over just because costs are going up while the revenue is staying flat, mm-hmm. right? And we're not doing tons of houses to, the cannery contributed a little bit more. Bretton Woods will contribute a little bit more. Mm-hmm. But that's the only way for it to actually increase is if we have, more houses that are contributing. So anyway, that's just to say I'm going to keep an eye on that, but we did exceed that number a little bit.
Wouldn't you expect over time maintenance to go up in percentage as you have more projects that have been done? Like if you're spending more and more on capital improvement, blah, 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 blah. But then wouldn't you need money to maintain that? So do they realize that there's, over time, there's kind of like a shift?
Well, this was an informal pledge just to sort of, and we took, there were there were a lot of other, there were some other staff people that were taking a percentage of Measure O.
Mm.
Taking, I mean, because at that time, that was 2008. Do everybody remember that?
Mm-hmm.
You know, I mean, everything was down and trying to avoid layoffs.
Mm-hmm.
They were open space related positions. They weren't just random positions because that would violate the provisions of the tax. But so we got that number way down. Mm-hmm. But you're right. I mean, I don't know, you know, we've done improvements, you know, I don't know if Chris, we spend more money now. I mean,
I guess I just wonder eventually if we get that, what is that, the land on the other side?
Yeah.
For sure.
You know, right?
Yeah.
It's like, okay, you've
yes.
purchased that, then you have
yeah.
like, so much more land.
Well, yes.
Mm-hmm. Are you really going to stay?
No, definitely not.
Yeah, no.
I mean, and that's kind of what I've been, I thought, well, you know, if we did get the Shoal property mm-hmm. or something like that, right? Then, you know, I mean, I would need another staff person or something,
mm-hmm.
right? So then there would be a whole discussion about, yeah, well, I'm going to have to.
But for now, since it's.
Right, we're sort of maintaining. Yeah, you're right, though. That's true. It can't be indefinite. And that, although at the same time, you know, if there are new developments
then, yeah,
passed,
that's true. Then it can. Still...
Then that'll go up a little bit. So,
mm-hmm.
you know, kind of see how it falls.
I think we had discussed this a couple meetings ago, the fact that the ratio is one-third. And I can't remember if there's a suggestion to include it in the general plan update that, you know, just the fact that we have the static parcel tax
mm-hmm.
That is not adjusted for inflation naturally means that we're going to need to adjust, you know, maintenance costs, and they're going to go up, and just, you know, have that be like a line
mm-hmm.
in there. I don't know if, like, you know, if somebody were to come back and you know, share their complaint, can point to something. I don't know.
Yeah,
right.
I mean, I'm not
right.
sure that would be
right.
something that would go in the general plan.
Mm-hmm.
That, and also,
so.
Like I said, this was an informal pledge.
Mm-hmm.
You know, we basically, you know, to calm the uproar about
mm-hmm.
the fund,
mm-hmm.
I started doing that spreadsheet showing everything in the measure, like what exactly we spent it on. So it was transparent. So you could
yeah.
see exactly what was coming out, and also said, hey, we hear you. And, you know, we won't get up to that 50% again, you know, unless there's some extenuating circumstance,
mm-hmm.
like, oh, well, we just got another 400 acres, so,
yeah.
you know, something big like that, right? But, like, what we have now, yeah, you're right, okay, given what we have now, Chris and I talked about, we're like, yeah, we can do this, we can manage everything and keep it under this
yeah.
third, but...
I think it's important to flip the idea around, because there will be back on the ballot, right, in
yeah.
6 years, yep. and people should know that we're not just pushing money... Sorry, we're not just redistributing because we want it to be. It's just that's the natural flow of, you know, a static tax.
Right.
Yeah.
I think also that's where the importance of communication comes in, of like that storytelling of like
mm-hmm.
how the impact of having additional staff that's helping with monitoring or developing
mm-hmm.
management plans or, you know, doing these prescribed burns like Chris and others are doing. So like having that in place before a vote or before a strategic
mm-hmm.
plan update or whatever, I think has a lot of value when it comes to things like that, when it comes to policy decisions.
Right.
I also have a suggestion on verbiage here on this slide. You're saying no more, and then you say will be, and I think it should say should be instead of will be. If this is more of a pledge,
well,
and
this
not
is a,
so much
it
a
was
policy.
A principle. It was a, yeah.
Because when I read it, I was like, ooh, we're over the rule, you know?
Mm-hmm.
I didn't
no,
know it was
no
an
rule.
Informal
yeah.
sort
yeah,
of
it's
thing.
Yeah, it's a budget goal.
It's a
goal,
right?
It's
so
goal.
I think will be interpreted by the opponents as you're violating something,
yeah.
and well, we're really not.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Yeah, I can change that to would, no problem.
Yeah, would be, yeah.
Yeah.
Great.
Mm.
Just
yeah.
diffuse that.
Yeah. Yeah.
Hmm.
Yeah.
I mean, that's why, right, that's why to me too, like, the visuals of the map showing the, you know, easements that Measure O contributed to, and because this money, the 33%, you know, it's sort of invisible, right? It just sort of goes to kind of just keep things the way they are, right? So there'll have to be a good chronology of, like, some of the other, you know, some of the, not just the acquisitions, but, you know, capital improvements and things like that that have been done with Measure O, you know what I mean?
Mm-hmm.
And then for this, for 24-25, then the only other kind of new thing, in addition to the things that I said are going to roll over, the wetlands project and things like that, I just asked for 30 grand for the interpretive panels for the upland habitat area, and that is going to be Measure O, because I kind of want Measure O to just be for that whole habitat restoration. So then if you go to the next one, it'll kind of then again show you sort of the, how things sort of break down again. You know, the impact fees, again, are taking up a big chunk, but that's also because, again, like you said, that's primarily the UCD wetlands design rolling over, and that was paid for with the impact fees. But like you said, I intend to, or I want to, because, again, these are just soft costs, right? They're not.
Yeah.
So when we get a grant and we have to do matching funds, my intention was that those would be Measure O, right? So to kind of, you know, because then that would be towards the actual construction.
Mm-hmm.
So you can see that, you know, again, I try to keep our reliance on the general fund as low as possible, because there's so much more fluctuation in that. But, you know, depending on our developments, eventually we're going to run out of impact fees. And unless, you know, those are reliant on the development, right? But so, you know, it's possible, depending on how things go in the future, Measure O could be much more important to this budget. There'll have to be some reassessments of how much is spent on.
So just that Measure O fund line says 477.
Yeah.
500. And you just said we're usually get 700.
Well, because this is what is in our budget, in the program budget,
so
not
we'll
in
bank
the fund.
Some, we'll bank 230,000.
Right.
So we're using because that. The rest of it that's not shown, although it's
goes
sort of
into
shown
a reserve.
It goes into the fund balance.
And the fund is has quite a balance, right?
Yeah, it has 7.1 million in it.
And the purpose of that reserve fund is.
Well, this is where the parcel taxes go. So when the parcel taxes are collected, they all go into this restricted fund.
Oh.
So we have 7 million available to us
right
currently.
So
of Measure O funds that are
so
unspent.
Let's say if we want to make a big fee title acquisition,
like the
then
software.
Then we
yes.
would have it and
got
not
it.
Have just what we get
yeah.
for 1 year, right?
Yeah, that makes sense.
So, and that, but on the other hand, you know, before, you know, 2030, it would be good if something big happened, because
can't be going into the.
You gotta just have something to show for it.
And
yeah.
we have to be sitting on $10 million.
Right.
Not only
that, so
not only that, but that's the whole point of, you know, of the measure, right?
Yeah.
But it's not like we could buy a little piece of land every year that would be just the amount spent.
Right, it depends on.
It has
yeah.
to be opportunity, it has to be. And
that's
the complication.
Seller.
Yeah.
it's not, yeah, it's not easily, it's not easy to plan.
Right.
You know, because it is, it's dependent.
And that's the difficulty.
Got it. It's good.
So then if you go to the expenses, then, that's just a pie chart that I kind of have just for the public. But then the expenses, then you can kind of see where things kind of fall, because it's, so again, you can see what's kind of left to spend from the wetlands project, the signage project. The signage project is split between, so that the first, that top part, this part here, is, you know, this part is the things that are coming out of the Measure O fund.
Right.
So that's how you get, see there, you can see the 477,500.
Right.
And then the top part is everything else. So like the open space impact fees and the general fund and everything else is up above. So that's the 774,900.
I see. So, yeah, that explains it.
Yeah.
Thank you.
So that's kind of how it shakes out. And again, that's just the budget. Are there any questions about that at all? They're kind of similar to the previous year. You can keep going. And then, you know, we have these goals that are sort of just things that we're working on. We don't have to go into them again. This is more for kind of, you guys are all aware of these goals. They're more for just kind of the public, if the public is interested. And then, so if you go to the fund balances, then you can see, yeah, we have, you know, what's left in terms of, again, these are the three funds that are restricted to, that are restricted to open space purposes.
I had a question on the goals, actually.
Oh.
As what was and what's meant by continue organizing community events? Which events are we talking? Like,
oh, well,
the
Chris,
public meetings for the wetlands, or like what other events?
Well, no, what I was more, that was more like Chris organizes a lot of volunteer like maintenance events where
planting,
he works with like,
like
he's working with the friends, the friends in North Davis Pond, or the people, there's a regular group that sort of helps him along the Buda Creek Parkway, there's people that help him in South Fork, things like
that's
that.
That's a little misleading then, as you're
why is that misleading?
Well, I just think community events makes you think like invitations to come out and visit the open space, or like art in open space area, or not like volunteer
community volunteering events would be better.
Well, that's, I mean, it's fine. I was just like, oh, what community events did I miss in the open space? But I mean, you can leave it as it is, but I thought, oh, that's an interesting goal of like some other projects for public engagement, public access engagement. So I was like, I missed that one. But
yeah,
I mean, the UC Davis wetland public meetings is what I thought.
Oh, yeah. No, those are, I kind of think of those as different. Those are like public, those are to get feedback on something.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, a community event also could potentially be, you know, if we can get, we've been trying to, you know,
like
the Buda Creek Council, like the docent led tours, that Buda Creek Council kind of stopped those.
Okay.
And Chris is working with them to try to get those started up again.
Okay.
Because Mark Kushofsky still wants to do those. So we've been, and I don't know, you know, the Buda Creek Council has been going through a lot of staff transition, and they just haven't had the bandwidth recently to get to work with us to get those started again. But that kind of would fall in there too, in my eyes, kind of, you know.
Okay. Thank you.
Okay. So then on the fund balances, so yeah, so then you see those three, so you can see those funds. If you ever are bored sometime and you want to go look at the city budget, the big one that's on the city's website, there's like a list, there's like pages of fund this, fund, you know, seven, fund, there's a bazillion funds. And So these are the three. So there's a page for Fund 135, Fund 142. Anyway, these are the three that are where funds, the revenues are restricted to open space related purposes. So, so yeah, you can see that we have about 8.6 million in there.
Yeah, this is where my Fund 42 could be used for a bike rack at the North Davis point, like near where the signage will go in at the North Davis site. Because when I went to go, Tracy, to look at, to give you ideas, I'm like, well, where do I put my bike, actually?
At where? I'm sorry, I didn't hear where.
The North Davis Pond site.
Oh.
And I'm like, that bike racks could be like capital improvements, especially near the signs, and sort of welcome you to stop and look.
There are no bike racks?
There, I mean, there are on the other side of the pond near the viewing deck. But
yeah, I guess not
side.
In the...
Those are some of the ideas. I'm like, well, maybe they meet some of our goals and would be a capital improvement. Would it encourage sleeping?
Well, and I could use Measure O for that, too.
Yeah.
Okay.
So yeah, that,
anyway, those are some of the thoughts.
Go over well.
Or those, I think I sent you this. I mean, this, like those library boxes, even like the... Just put it, like, to encourage people to come to the space for multiple reasons.
That's a good idea.
But just another potential.
Yeah.
Random, sort of random idea.
But it,
engagement.
Engagement. Yeah, those
signs,
are those
the
are good.
The signs that are put out.
Those
yeah.
are good.
Small things.
Are they out there already? The signs?
Not
the signs? No, no, not yet. No. They have still not still being finalized, and they need to be, although they get manufactured really fast. I mean, once they're finalized, they're actually done pretty quick. Okay, so you can go to the number 20. So then this one just shows you a partial of the spreadsheet. It goes all the way to year one, which is kind of the 2001-2002 fiscal year, but I, you know, obviously can't fit that all on the page. So those are all hid. Those years are hidden, but the total, you can kind of see from the total line what has accumulated over the years in each of those line items. So yeah, so in that fund right now we have like 7.1 million left, and so, you know, when you look at it, when you look up above, you know, that's roughly half of the revenue that's come in.
That ever came in, you mean?
It has ever come in.
Yeah.
So, you know, we're way past the halfway mark.
Yeah.
$5.
Time. It's time to go shopping.
Yeah. So, thank you, Tracy, for putting this together. I think it's really helpful to see all the numbers, and I think it's a question of looking at sort of where the program's been and where it's going. Just thinking about, I mean, you have these budget principles, but I guess those are, do you have budget goals, like targets for the remaining years for Measure O funds? And like, are they, could they be something similar, like, you know, a percentage on acquisition? I mean, but forward looking, that then you could tell the story of, well, there were no willing sellers and these are what we export, to sort of give that, hey, we're looking ahead. In a quantitative way as well?
Well, I mean, I guess the thinking was that two-thirds, you know, that was, you know, the thought was that, you know, at the end of the day, you know, I would want to say, hey, you know, since whatever, I kind of started doing this in 2015, or well, 2016, 17, somewhere around there. Not right when I first got here.
Sure.
But, you know, since that time, since we kind of you know, it was sort of the midway point of the tax when we kind of did the assessment of like, okay, where are we? What's going on? You know, since that kind of midway point, I kind of wanted to say yes, that, you know, over that second half, the last 15 years or whatever, we spent, you know, about 2/3 of what came in on either buying property, buying easements, or doing capital improvements, you know, and a third of it was spent on just sort of taking care of stuff, you know?
Yeah.
But I didn't have like, because again, it's so, I don't know, it really does depend on, you know, who kind of appears as a willing seller, you know?
Yeah. It just seems like there's also all the other goals in the strategic plan as well, like partnerships or, you know, target of leveraging, you know, of whatever acquisitions, like certain, we're targeting this amount of cost share or matching fee, like grants or, you know, just to show some goals of like forward looking, like this is really great, like backward looking and current fiscal accountability, but like here are our principles sort of moving forward and how we want to invest the 2/3, not only for capital improvements and acquisitions, but also these other elements that are important to the program, like this, or, you know, like that align with these specific strategic plan goals around access or some of the, I guess those are the ones that are most on my mind, like public partnerships and public access and engagement. So
yeah.
And I know we've like talked about the monitoring and the management plan components, like, and that could be a component of it as well. So just a thought, but
yeah, I mean, I guess those are, I guess the way I've been thinking about it is like those things, not that they're not important, but they're, I see them as sort of part of the ongoing operations, right? Those are like the ongoing things that we're doing all the time or want to do all the time, right?
Mm-hmm.
I don't know if I could say, could tie those to a particular amount of Measure O funding. Spent, you know, like, oh, I want to spend, my goal is to spend $200,000 in Measure O funds on, you know, increasing partnerships. I'm not sure I would be able to track that, to be honest with you, or even figure out how I would be able to do that within the city's finance system, to be clear,
sure.
Honest.
Okay.
You know, I don't know if I have that level of, I would be able to have that level of specificity where I'd be able to like make some, you know, pledges on some of these action items and say, I want to, you know, target this amount of funds, but I would be no way that I would be able to sort of track that, I guess is what I'm saying.
Yeah, well, maybe if it's not at that granularity, like having these sort of high level principles, because the public, I don't think knows that, like, those are key elements of the decisions necessarily.
The budget principles?
Yeah,
what,
like,
are you looking,
like,
at?
What you just said in
terms of,
oh, yeah, budget, but like just at a high level, like, oh, we're seeking matching funds or, you know, like how we're leveraging your tax dollars, right?
Yeah, although that was one of the big things that we did at the halfway mark was, I don't know if anybody's looked at it, but we did this huge background, we did this huge midterm report where we, and it's on the website where it does say how we leveraged Measure O to get, you know, at that time, because that was the first 15 years. So the first 15 years we were all about leveraging, you know, trying to stretch the dollar as far as possible. We still are, but we really were then, right?
Right.
And so that midterm report that is in the financial accountability section on the website was the 15-year mark of Measure O, and it kind of was meant to, we did publicize it, we, you know, had the city council, you know, announcements about it, where we were trying to tell people, okay, Measure O has been in place for 15 years, what has it been used for? What did we do with it? And a big part of it was showing how, you know, we were able to, how much, how many grant dollars we were able to get versus the amount of Measure O that we put in to these different acquisitions. So it was heavy on the, hey, we leveraged, you know, X millions of your Measure O tax dollar to get these acquisitions, you know, tables. So we did do that at the 15-year point. I mean, I don't know. I mean, yeah, maybe we'll do something similar at the end. I hear you, because I get that people don't know, but I don't know. I'm just saying, we did at least attempt to kind of do that in year 15,
yeah,
to kind of show people that, you know, we were able to get.
Yeah, I guess when
I... And I think we still show it. I mean, it's presented in this document that...
Well, yeah.
Right, that you know, some grants came in, and that's in a good chunk of what we used to pay for those.
But yeah, I mean, I don't really, I don't like, yeah, for a while there, we did as a commission and think about like trying to do these 5-year, like looking forward
mm-hmm.
plans, but
mm-hmm.
to be honest, they were sort of, I don't know.
Not really.
They were, I don't know how useful they were.
Yeah, they weren't that useful.
They weren't that useful, and so we kind of stopped doing it, and instead we sort of, you know, we would look at the action items, we would look at this. I don't know. We didn't kind of say, okay, over the next 5 years, we're going to do X, Y, and Z.
That's
you know?
Helpful, too. Like, what, I guess, what wasn't useful about them?
You couldn't really anticipate the opportunities, for one thing, that were going to be around, new ideas. It felt like we put more work into trying to prognosticate what was going to happen over the next 5 years than really it was guiding us anywhere differently than having just the strategic plan.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, and then things would happen, like these development projects would come, and then all of a sudden we'd have to drop everything and like focus on, you know,
yes,
feedback on these development projects, because they would come to us, and so then we'd kind of, you know, then that would just, things that we, it, yeah, it just seemed like it was hard to, especially on the, you know, acquisition, the big things like the acquisitions and whatnot. I don't know. It didn't seem like it was helping
mm-hmm.
plan out things.
What's the difference between these 5-year plans and a strategic plan?
There is one of the action items. The strategic plan. One of the action items was, oh, well, we should
do 5-year plans.
We should do these little 5-year plans.
Yeah. Okay.
Right? And so we did. Paper. We tried to do them, and then went, you know, we did them a couple of times.
Yeah.
And then we're like, what? This is not worth the time and effort.
Yeah, okay.
It's not helping.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know. It just didn't seem like it was helping.
So we have a strategic plan.
Yeah. We have a strategic plan. That's, yeah.
Yeah. Well, this is just it's on.
Those are the action items and objectives and
goals.
Yeah.
That's
a strategic plan. Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, that's
yeah.
That's the condensed part of it.
And this was approved by the city council in 2018.
Yeah. This looks very reminiscent of general plan planning.
Mm-hmm.
With the structure.
Yeah, although it doesn't do any land use planning.
Okay, right.
It's
no, but I mean
about,
in terms
like,
of like what we do,
yes,
that's what I interpreted this to be.
Yeah.
So,
right.
Good.
Which
it's
is
really good.
Which is it was. It was like, okay, what is the program gonna focus on?
Yeah.
You know, in the next, you know, because again, this was 2018. So again, it was sort of the midpoint of the tax. So we were like, okay, for the next 15 years. That's what it was sort of meant to be. It was like, okay, we got 15 years left of Measure O.
So
what are we going to work on for the 15 years?
This is not in the general plan.
No, no.
No.
This could guide us somewhat.
Some of it. For
the update.
Well, definitely. Well, yeah, I guess some of it could. Like the acquisition section in terms of target areas.
But in terms of goals, articulating goals and objectives, you've done a great job here.
Well, we all, it wasn't just me.
Yeah,
no,
what I mean is the group did a great job. I wasn't involved. So I find this a great step forward for us
Yeah.
In the updating process.
It was a lot of work, and it also came out of a big community meeting that we had in 2016.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
So we had a big community meeting.
Oh, I remember that.
I'd say community process, including a meeting.
Yeah, it was more than just one meeting. And so out of that, we thought, you know, let's consult. We didn't really have, the city had a management plan, but it really was only focused on acquisitions.
Oh.
Like, how do we make decisions about what easements? Right. So we decided at that time, you know what, because people were saying, we're talking about habitat restoration, all this stuff that we had nothing. So it was like, you know what, we need to expand that and make it all these focus on these subject areas that people care about. And so that's why we decided, okay, this is the document that we want to show people, hey, over the next 15 years, these are the things that we're going to be focusing on, these action items.
I would like to say that we're sitting on $1.2 million of the impact fees, and from what I'm gathering, there is like a sense of urgency to spend those relatively soon. And, you know, we come up with some ideas, you know, we could build some bike racks, we could build, you know, some other things here and there, but I would like to hear from some of the people organizing the community events that we're talking about. Perhaps the friends of, you know, Wood Creek might come up with better ideas that we can think of, because they're out there actually on the ground, you know, pretty often, more often than I, or other organizations around here who are actually, you know, actively around Wood Creek or in the city itself, we could find stuff that we probably couldn't. I'm just communicating that with them so they can come to us and be like, well, we have these propositions and we have this one.
Yeah, well, that is how we did that, the Upland project. The friends came to us, we talked to them, you know, we decided it wasn't an open space area.
Mm-hmm.
Went to the city council, got it deemed an open space area, so I could spend Measure O. And right, they said you should use Measure O and do a habitat restoration here. And so we said, okay, that's what we'll do. So we did that, and that's why I kind of want to keep it all in the same fund and use mm-hmm. the interpretive, because the interpretive panels were part of the habitat restoration.
Mm-hmm.
So yes. That was one kind of project that completely came up from the community group.
Yeah.
You know, I mean, again, like if we do, you know, a Peshol or we do a Shonan-ing, however you pronounce that, you know, those aren't going to involve grants, so that's going to be a big chunk of it.
Mm.
You know.
Do we know for sure they're not going to involve grants?
No, I don't. But
why are you saying they're not going to involve grants?
Well, I guess because, you know, I don't know. I suppose it could, because we could argue that it's like riparian. It could, potentially. It just takes a lot longer. So I guess I was thinking that, it's sometimes hard to, like for example, that was smaller, the little 10 acres to the west. Mm-hmm. You know, when you're negotiating,
yeah.
You know, it's hard to get, if you're trying to get somebody to give you, they don't really want to give it to you.
And then to have to go through the application process.
But you have to go through this whole 2-year process with me to get this grant. Bye.
Yeah.
It's like, boy.
Got it.
But
I'm with you.
But on the other hand, maybe if there's need for being a lot of restoration there.
But the restoration,
then,
it's
appropriate, and then the time scale works, right?
Yeah, but like, right, the restoration, I always have kind of thought that would be for sure, like, because again, that's more also, I think, kind of more of a something that would be relevant for the grant, right?
Mm-hmm.
To restore something that's, to increase the riparian habitat, right?
Right.
Do you have any kind of estimate as to how much that property would cost? Is that going to, you know...
Oh, yeah, I mean.
H&M.
Yes, I mean, well.
It's gonna be curious how much would that totally wipe it out? In that case.
Well, if we ever get to something on Peshaw, that'll be, you know, probably in the $6 million range. Because it's.
Peshaw is the one with the walnuts?
Yeah.
Okay, and that's, so that's still on the new side.
It's like 200 acres that's in between the levees, it's a big piece.
Yeah, directly to the east.
Yeah.
And the other one?
And the west side.
Well, the other one, that would be similar, it's a little smaller, but not much.
Yeah.
So that's why I'm saying I can't really do both. Well, right now, you know, like, if Measure O passes again, you know, I mean, and then, you know, there's always, you know, so, but yeah, it's,
Well, it's good to know that it would.
Yeah, no, it would use that big.
It.
Because that would be a fee title acquisition. The thing with these easements, they're great, but now, especially with these salt these sustainable agricultural land conservation program, that's the Department of Conservation, those are the grants that we usually get, you know, to expand their pool, which is great, they've lowered the requirement of the matching fund. So before it was 25%, now it's only 10%. And so you can get a pretty sizable easement with not putting in very much money at all. And so that, which is good for everybody, but it's also like, okay, it makes it hard to use our matching funds because each easement is you know, it's only 10%.
Which is, yeah, generally good for every.
Well, I'm not going to complain.
Generally
about
good.
That.
Yeah. It's just one of the reasons why it's been, you know, it takes a while. It would take a major, like, fee title acquisition to really drop the number.
I think maybe to what you were saying, I wasn't following completely, but yeah, really showing kind of, I think it's one of those, for every $1 of O, Measure O, we actually, the value was like $20 or whatever.
Okay.
Something like that.
That we leveraged, yes.
Yeah, I don't know what it is.
Yes.
But like seeing that kind of statistic would be like, oh wow, it's actually like, because we had this, now there's like this massive value that we were able to.
We kind of did that in that report.
Yeah, and it'd be cool to know that, like, that ratio, I guess.
Yes, I don't know what it is right now, but like we did do it. I forget what the ratio was in 2015 or whenever, 2016 when we did it. Honestly, I mean, I don't know. Yeah, maybe things have changed. It didn't seem like people, that wasn't really what people, they liked that.
Yeah.
But they were more interested, well, you know, why, you know, everything you've protected is so far away, I can't even see it, I can't even walk on it.
I cannot walk on it.
That was really the only thing that people cared about.
And
I see.
Well, it's also, like, what did you say, what year was that?
2016.
A lot has changed since 2016 as well.
Yeah.
So, I mean, it wouldn't necessarily have to be a whole report. Like, I think there's a once a month, right, social media thing. Like, if you're looking for more content, it could be like, oh, like, fun fact.
By the way.
Yeah, and then you could just collect all those over time for a larger story.
Yeah.
So it's
a footprint online.
But.
Like a potential, like you had a, just like a little stat that your dollar is at work in a specific way, but not a really detailed analysis of everything, but just maybe on one project, highlighting one project.
Yeah.
It could help with the storytelling, I think, to your point as well, Christina.
No, I can definitely, I mean, again, I've been trying to, you know, work with the communications team to do those like monthly things, and then, you know, then everything was sort of put in pause mode until the election. And so now I can kind of think of that again. And that's, you know, maybe I can try and think of, like, some little
Like an example one, not like a whole.
Yeah, just like you said, like a little, just a little statistic, a little fun fact, just, you know, just a little something that they can send out on just a little, you know, social media blurb.
But to come back to the fee acquisition land, it would solve a lot of those, you know, expectation of the public is that I want that land to be able to walk on it. I want to be able to enjoy it. And when it's an ag easement, it's just, you know, being preserved out there. But
That's a harder stuff.
What is in there for me, you know? Except not seeing another town being developed there, but, you know. So.
But you could still tell some of the stories there, even with like UC Davis, like just bringing out different pieces of it.
Yeah. And like, that's another one that would use some of that money is the wetlands, you know, because the matching funds for, I don't know, I have no idea what that's going to cost, but it still has the bridge in it. So, you know, and I don't know what the percentage of matching funds that the Wildlife Conservation Board, but that'll be a big number, probably whatever the matching funds are for that. So that's something that will take a big chunk, right?
Yeah.
So, I don't know, in my mind, I'm kind of hoping, I don't know, maybe, and I'm just thinking like between that project and one of these.
Yeah, that would be great.
Along the creek, you know, something's got to work out. I did meet with, I guess, I don't know, I suppose it's okay to talk about. I did meet with, you know, the broker that's working with me, and he had kind of a new little strategy, so we're going to try something new in Peshawl. He thinks that something is going to happen in the spring because, you know, he's had two harvests now, and he says that, you know, that something is probably some deal is going to percolate around in the spring. So that's what I'm hoping.
Yeah.
Good.
So I'll look into that. I think that's a good idea, and I will try to do that. I mean,
definitely.
Chris and I are always thinking of that too. You know, with some of the friends groups, the thing with those is, you know, there aren't that many, and there isn't that. That's why the Ethan Anderson site was so great, because it was just this really unique little vacant piece of property that, you know, this community group really wanted to be an open space area. And, you know, we just don't have that many parcels like that laying around.
If any? Mm-hmm. If we could identify any of them?
No, we don't have any.
No other?
Mm-hmm. Nothing like that. Mm-hmm. I mean, if there was, you know, something, a new thing would probably be outside the city limits, right? That one was so great because it was inside the city limits already, you know, and so we could point to a habitat restoration inside the city limits.
And it was never developed. It was not like you had like something, you know,
right?
Cannery on it or something. Which
right, there's nothing on it, so that was good too. And fortunately, there wasn't any really. I will point out, though, just, you know, we did talk about this before, and, you know, like I said, I put it on one of the interpretive panels, the drafts there, is that, you know, if you go online and you look at the Village Farms plan, right, there's a crossing there, pedestrian bike crossing. So there's a landing that comes down onto that property, which that property was always kind of thought of as the future landing for a bike ped overcrossing. So it is on the Village Farms kind of plan at the moment.
So in the interest of tonight's schedule, and we're already kind of doing it anyway, let's transition over to the strategic plan.
I think that's kind of the end of the budget. Unless anybody have any other budget questions? You can always email me later if you have another one. Nothing? Going.
Okay. That's good. Thanks for putting that together.
Yeah, that's awesome.
Yeah.
Thanks, Tracy.
made some copies. If, I know people have computers, but I made some copies if anybody wants another one. I didn't make copies for everybody.
I have my own.
Usually people.
Where is the rest of the stuff?
It should be on the open space website, I would think, in the city, the strategic plan.
Yeah, so if you go to the open space website, there's a little sidebar tab and it says.
Nobody's gonna take it.
Financial and program accountability. And if you click on that tab, it'll, there's a link.
Your comment earlier, did you do a, when we joined the commission, you did a presentation, overview presentation on the strategic plan? But maybe now that we're doing this, you don't need to, but maybe in the next time there are new commission members, I thought that was a helpful presentation to see.
Yeah, I didn't do that kind of overview in September. I sent them, over the summer.
Oh, okay, they got it.
I sent the new commissioners like a little like, hey, this would be good to read and take a look at it. Let me know if you have questions, right? I think I did that. But I didn't give them a presentation, but yeah.
So how do you want to go through this?
Well, so I'm open to suggestions. I also thought, you know, we don't have to go through the whole thing tonight. Just, you know, we can kind of look at one section. You know, it's just something that you guys, it's also for all of us to use going forward. We can have it on the agenda as a recurring item for a while and, you know, maybe do one section at a time or whatever you want. I mean, I'm open to suggestions. This is more just, I kind of did the whole thing because I just thought, well, and again, this is just my sort of first shot at kind of thinking about all these different items and kind of where we are, but we don't have to talk about page one. We don't have to do acquisitions tonight. We can do a different section. If people want time to review it more thoroughly, if you haven't, I can put it on the next agenda, whatever you want. I'm kind of open to
anything. I was trying to remember.
I mean, I personally think if people have like specific questions, we could start there. At least I have specific questions, but I like the idea of keeping it as a recurring item too for those who didn't have time to read it or like digesting it further than the next month goes on.
We could also, use tonight, you know, it's 10 to 8. We could use tonight as sort of kind of general questions, or if there are specific things that people read and they don't understand what I wrote or disagree with it, and then we can put it on again if you want to go into more detail in a particular section.
I don't want to go line by line tonight through this thing.
No, and that wasn't really the intention of this. It was more just to kind of, again, kind of as an exercise, and this is a document that I can change. You know, it's kind of a living document.
Mm-hmm.
It was more to kind of give everybody sort of a general idea of, you know, what the action items were, number one, for some of the new, just remind us what they were, and then kind of to go through them and just sort of see, you know, and yeah, there are a couple, there are several that, you know, some of them, you know, I wrote, you might disagree with me, but, you know, I wrote in them like, these were sort of a one-time research effort. We just kind of looked into it. It's not really feasible, and we're kind of done with this action item, right? So some of them, that's what I wrote.
Okay.
You might not agree with me, so that's what I mean. Like, you know, you want to take more time to look through these, but, you know, some of them, that's what I wrote, where I thought, you know, because in my mind I thought, with the different things that we're focusing on, that one was sort of a lower priority. I don't know if we need to do any further research on it. I feel like it's sort of done.
Right.
But you might disagree. So that's, I kind of, on here, you know, you can see I either categorize them as one-time things or ongoing things that we kind of, you know, are always doing or will always be doing. They're never kind of done. The original version of this, when Carrie Shaw was the one that kind of set it up. The final column, it had actually a percentage complete thing where we had, you know, what percentage complete, and I ditched that because it was like, there's no way I can do this.
Right.
I mean, I would just be totally drawing a number out of the sky.
42.7.
So it was like, I wouldn't even know what the percentage of it was, right?
Yeah.
So I got rid of that and I changed. So that's why I said I sort of started looking at them as items that were one-time things,
mm-hmm.
and then items that were sort of ongoing things. And for the one-times,
is it
I either
done?
Said they were done or they're not done.
Yeah.
And then for the ongoing, I kind of said either and I kind of tried to list, like, okay, either we actually did some things under this action item, you know, and made some progress, or we didn't,
mm-hmm.
you know? And so that's kind of how I filled it out.
Okay, I just brought one up to Patrick. It's sort of something that was came onto my radar screen 10, 15 years ago during the HCP planning process and my own teaching.
Mm-hmm.
I have a studio of the West Davis Ponds, and I have a studio project that we presented here at one point. Restoring up detention basins into something ecologically functional,
mm-hmm.
like the West Ponds.
Mm-hmm.
It's under habitat restoration enhancement. It's on your page 1, 2.
So
it's
like the
red page 4.
Mm-hmm.
In the red section,
The red section where it says no progress.
Oh, yeah. That one, the yellow one.
Caught my attention. I read it.
It's like,
that's like one of my pet projects.
That slough
is the beginning. It's the headwaters of the Cobell Ditch.
Yes, it is.
So,
yes, it is.
We tracked
it. And
it
goes
almost
to Poudre Creek.
Yes. In fact, it's probably an old channel or distributary of Poudre Creek in the old days. And it's really the only topography besides Poudre Creek that we've got. It really, really is unique. It's super unique in the sense that the only other place I could think of that comes close to it would be the cemetery here in East Davis,
mm-hmm.
with that little channel that they keep filling in as much as they can to put houses on top of it and graves or whatever. But there's very, very little left of the natural topography that actually functioned as topography and actually drained land in this area, because farmers were just so good at leveling everything and getting
mm-hmm.
their parcel perfect for their feeder line, you know, their irrigation ditches and stuff.
Mm-hmm.
We virtually have flattened everything, you know.
Mm-hmm.
And there are a lot of reports that used to be rolling hills in this area, you know, that are basically been scraped and filled in and just laser leveled for practical purposes.
Mm-hmm.
But these remnants, like this
that
little
slew.
Spot
mm-hmm.
and the spot in the cemetery, they're things that should be treated, I think, with more intent, like for their unique natural value. It has these very cool plants in them. The part that's on the, what branch is that?
Does everyone know what we're talking about?
Could you show me on the?
It's actually.
Talking about this
off. It's off. Okay. There it is, right there. Yeah,
yeah.
You see that thing right there? That's it,
there.
Yeah. You see, you can actually see it.
So what it does, so just for everybody.
And then it goes straight north. Comes from the hills.
It comes down, and so it goes, this isn't Poudre Creek, but it was like a tributary,
it's
right?
Like some weird
thing. So it kind of goes through this private property here. Now, we have an easement right here.
Hmm.
Oh, how interesting. So that far right, that right where you ended, you're right there. So
not
that is what we traced back to the, you see the detention basin there, right off Covell, that one. So that channel that you were just on to the left of you just feeds that.
Well, it goes, so this goes this comes down here and it hits here.
And goes straight north.
It goes in this dumb little ditch right here.
Yep.
Here.
Makes it right.
And it goes here, uh-huh, so you see it. Yeah, some of it spills into here occasionally, but then it goes along here.
And then it shifts.
Goes up here.
To the north of Covell.
And then it goes here.
That's right.
Oh, yeah.
That's exactly right.
And then it goes under.
Yep.
And then 113.
Under 113.
And it becomes the North Davis Channel.
Exactly.
And it goes so down here, it's, and it goes all the way.
Yeah, it's a complete hydrologic system.
Yeah. Yeah, it's,
and we studied this whole thing, and it was fascinating to me at the time. But and so that's how it ended up in the HCP, and I don't know how it got in here, but maybe through you. I don't know, because we've been talking a lot.
Probably.
I've always wondered about it.
Yeah, it's a really
interesting thing. It goes further west, too.
It keeps going and going and going, and it's all, you know, I don't know where our planning boundary is, but I would not like to give up on it.
It's
even if
it's
private.
Just, this guy isn't really
not talkative.
Cooperative.
Okay.
But Steve, you had, when you were talking to me just now, you had the idea too that it doesn't necessarily need to be us personally doing it.
Yeah.
But we can work with our YOLO RCD.
RCD, I think, is, you know, they really deal with the private people. So
maybe
we could encourage or reach out or do whatever we can to, like, I don't know, enhance that waterway. It is a waterway. Temporarily.
Well, one of the reasons though that we did have it in here was if we were gonna spend time doing it, wishful thinking, we're thinking, we get a public access, benefit, right?
Totally.
So, you know, get some kind of connection.
Yeah.
So we have, you know, a public access easement or something like that. So in addition to the restoration, there would be some kind of, in exchange for us using money, if we're going to use money, we're not going to just improve this guy's private property.
I totally agree with you.
There would have to be something.
Something.
And that's what's hard, because this guy isn't...
Not so into it.
Not into it.
Mm-hmm.
So,
well, maybe it becomes a future item, like a placeholder, instead of saying, like, we're not going
to
look into this anymore.
It just says no
problem.
The problem is that in the box to the left, it says may not be feasible.
Well, I just said may not be feasible. That doesn't mean
it may not be.
It may not be.
But it may.
It does.
Because, again, for those reasons, we're not going to use public dollars on this guy.
Yeah, okay.
It doesn't say it's impossible.
That's right.
Well, I would like to soften that a little bit. Maybe currently not feasible or something like that. Because how it sounds in here
is
that we're giving up on it.
Okay. Well, that wasn't what I meant, but I see what you mean. I can definitely change it. This is just me typing away.
Exactly.
But we also have to be sensitive that this is a public document and that landowner could read this and be like,
I know. Believe me, I actually almost didn't get this to you guys.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And then I thought, that's a strategic plan. It probably should be public. And I was like,
this is not part of the document on the web.
It was in your packet, so now it is.
Yeah.
I see. Thank you. Okay.
Well, it's in the strategic plan, but not my little comment.
Yeah.
Right.
Oh.
The action item is in the strategic plan.
I'm starting to sort this out now. Thank you.
This whole
so it's a progress report.
The part that's white is isn't in the strategic plan either.
Oh.
But these are my comments. But these all the action items
that comes out of
this is just straight out of the strategic plan.
Great. That was just an example.
Yeah.
Oh, cool. I have a question for Tracy.
Yeah, go for it.
First, thank you for doing this. I think it's really helpful to see what's been done. I encourage you to put a date on the document as like a standalone, because I think that's helpful. And I guess from your perspective, typing away and looking at what has been done and where we've made progress, and even where it's progress but not quite complete, like what was your sense of your highest priorities going into 2025?
Oh, of all of these things?
Yeah. Across, did you feel like, we've done a lot in one area, but I'd like to do more in another, or
I mean,
the progress, or?
I felt really good about the financial
I know that's the driest, most boring section, but I felt really good about it because when we started, it was zero.
Oh, yeah,
and when I was kind of going through it, I'm like, you know what, we really did a lot, you know, and it kind of made me feel good that we actually, you know, actually
got the mess cleaned up,
completed almost all of that. And, you know, I don't know, that section in particular, when I was going through it, I'm like, but yeah, that makes me feel really good.
Which section are you talking about?
The pink, the financial and program accountability.
Okay, okay.
Because we started at such a low place.
Yeah.
And, you know, there was a lot in here, actually.
Yeah.
And, you know, when I kind of looked at it, you know, because again, it's only been 5 years since we started working on this. And so we did accomplish quite a bit in 5 years.
There are a lot of done boxes there. Good.
I don't know, you know, on the, you know, I was, because of what we just have been talking about, I've been really focused on the acquisition. I was really kind of looking at, I was happy that I had something to say. Mm-hmm. You know, I could point to something in my mind about like, okay, you know, we are targeting, you know, the ones that we've done have really fallen into these categories that we kind of set out to do. I was pleased to kind of see that. Although again, some of them were ones that we haven't really done yet, like Peshol, but, you know, obviously that one is going to be a priority because that section is going to be a priority for me. It's just because, you know, we only have a few years left, and what we talked about in the last item about trying to spend those dollars.
And some of the other sections are kind of predicated on us getting properties to do those activities on.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, and, you know, the UCD project is a biggie. I mean, that one was also one that was nowhere, you know, that kind of came from meetings that Patrick had with Andrew Folks, and, you know, here now we have, you know, a whole plan, and we're doing construction documents. So I was really happy about that because, again, that's another way that we can spend Measure O.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah,
and there's definitely something that the citizens of Davis will enjoy, right? So,
oh yeah.
Yeah, that was kind of goes to my point, you know,
that's
thinking
big,
about the public access piece that we need to get some of these other properties to really enable that public access.
That's
it's not like we're holding on to big properties that don't have public access right now.
No, and that's why, like, you know, Peshol is so key because of having, we have the properties on both sides.
Yeah, that would be great,
You know?
But
I mean, because I feel like, you know, I guess in general, I felt, you know, because all the things that Chris is doing, I mean, also without Chris, I mean, Chris Gardner is so great. And I mean, he does so much with so little. And, you know, when I was, you know, he and I, in fact, you know, I had to meet with him to do the land management. The land and resource management, because that is a long section, or it was a lot in it, and, you know, I mean, yeah, we haven't done everything, but I mean, we've really done a lot in that section, and that stuff that just happens every year.
Cool.
Could we do more? Yes, I mean, but I think, you know, we're doing, given what we have, and that, you know, that we only have Chris, we're doing a lot of these things, you know, really trying to implement all of these things. I think we've made, you know, I want to do more on the signage, even more than what we're doing. You know, I'd like to do more of that NPS signage on some of our other areas, for sure. And, you know, I'd like to do more interpretive panels as well. So that's still in my mind, is like focusing on, in my mind, I'm trying to be honest with you, focus on things, you know, that the public will see.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, to really sort of, not that we haven't been focusing on that, but I'm extra kind of hyper-focused on it right now in terms of, like, you know, acquisitions that, you know, are close in or that are fee title that could be restored, that people could walk on, that, you know, signage, you know, trail, you know, the public accessibility improvements that we did, you know, just things that when people go to a place, they actually see, oh, I see this improvement, right? Like visual things. As much as I love partnerships and all of that, that is part of it. But again, you know, not that that's a lower priority. It's not, because a lot of those things involve partnerships. But I guess what I'm saying is that sort of my focus is trying to, you know, finish some of these, you know, continue on some of these things that, you know, like we've been talking about, that a few years from now we can say, point to and say, here are the things, here are the projects that, you know, Measure L contributed to, you know, that you're benefiting from, that you can see and use.
Yeah, I see some of what you're saying also in the blue public engagement and partnership piece, because I think some of those, like the signs are in there as well. I know the trail improvements are in green, but I think that's where my takeaway is, like, oh, most of those are noted as, a lot of these are noted as done, where it's the overall action or goal, I think, isn't necessarily done and speaks to what your priority is. So I'm just wondering if there's opportunity to look at some of those green items coupled with some of the blue items that can meet those, that priority you have of getting more people involved in seeing the progress, because I think you highlighted a lot of really great progress and how much is being done with so little, just engaging more people in that awareness and that story, I think will help you make progress on that priority and goal.
Yeah.
So, like, for example, use technology as a way to increase public engagement in the city's open space program. Like, both of the sub items are, like, done, but there's, like, likely more that can be done under that overarching goal.
Sure.
Those are some of the items. And to the extent, like, we can help with ideas or bringing, you know, supporting project implementation within those, I think those are...
Sure. And also I will say, you know, we always kind of said that that's the strategic plan, like these action items were, you know, what we came up with and what we, you know, the city council approved, what we're focusing on. But you're right, like the goal, it doesn't mean that, yeah, we can't say, you know, if we do complete, you know, like that one. Oh, we completed that. Well, what else could we maybe do under that goal, right? There's room to do that if we come up with something.
Yeah, like even your the social media once a month sort of
needs
that.
Yeah.
I think early on when we started, we met in these sub groups on these topics, and I feel like from you had a lot of ideas in this space, so... I don't know if done means, you know, shifting priorities to something else, or done means there's opportunity to
add new action.
Yeah. So not necessarily to accomplish on tonight's meeting, but something to think about. What does that mean in that goal area?
Are we just doing random things here?
What?
I just wonder, when can I type up?
You're the perfect person.
Yes. It's front of my class.
I think we are kind of doing random. I think what we're doing tonight, what are we doing?
Because I have one.
Tonight is sort of like, you know, getting everybody familiar with what this is.
And this is working.
Familiar with it. We're going to blah, blah, blah. But... you know, like I said, you know, we can just have this as a recurring item, you know, for some meetings and talk about, you know, some of these things. It could be a regular, you know, if we want it to be, it could be just a regular agenda item. Talk about the strategic plan.
Even, you know, randomly each
time. We can totally, we can.
Yeah. So I think we still have space for, you know, one or two more tonight. So, yeah, go for it.
In the financial and program accountability last page, the pink. When you brought it up, I started flipping through that section. And I was like, ooh, look at that one.
I'm scared of you.
This is good. This is good. Let's see. It's the second big line there.
Tell the number, none of it.
FPA1CC.
Okay. Now we're talking.
Research and implement, if feasible, relevant best practices used at local open space districts.
Yes.
And your response is, yeah, we've done that, but we can't really find anything good. And I know what you're talking about.
Yeah.
But I happen to know of a really good one.
Okay.
East Contra Costa. It's a county plan, and it's based on an HCP and CCP. But man, oh man, are they doing incredible things.
And how many people do they have?
Yeah, like a handful.
A handful? Okay.
They do a lot with a little. And I haven't checked in with them in many years, but the last I heard, about 3 or 4 pre-pandemic, they were just doing stellar work. They're doing restoration, public access. It's probably the best plan ever done in California or anywhere.
So what is it called?
East Contra Costa, HCP and CCP.
Oh, yeah.
And it's really worth checking out.
What is it? Is it what is it?
Great question.
Because they implement the HCP?
They're an implementation agency for their HCP and CCP.
But, I mean, we don't implement the HCP.
I know. So it's right. This would just be get ideas from this group that's doing amazing things.
Mm-hmm. Is it a JPA? Like ours?
It probably is. I think
most of those are run as JPAs.
I think it is. They had a really strong, you know, leader for a long time, and they got a lot done. I was really impressed with their work. And so I would just encourage maybe just a look at that as a possibility to help give us some good ideas.
Mm-hmm.
And of course, they're constrained by their HCP and CCP, unlike us, who we have a lot more freedom. It's not like we're implementing the YOLO HCP. Mm-hmm. We do if we want to, or if it works for us. Mm-hmm. But they're very habitat focused, mm-hmm. you know, because they're conserving endangered species. They got a long list there.
Yeah.
And a ton of development. So that's why theirs is development driven, whereas ours is really not. At least the YOLO HCP is not development driven, because we don't have enough development be driven by.
Mm.
So that's what's, you know, both a bad thing and a good thing for them, right? It's bad that they're losing all their open space to development, but they're getting a lot of money for it to do some decent mitigation work.
Mm.
Mm-hmm.
And they're doing the best that I've seen of anyone. So anyway, that's just my thought on that.
There's also the open space for all, outdoor access for all, state level priority that the governor passed in 2021, I think. And there's like a strategy access for all strategy and best, I think, in 2023, I think, last year that came out. And that's through all the like 30 by 30 goals, as well as outdoor for all priority of the governor. And there's more databases available to map. I think I sent you at one point, but it's also a way to find other programs.
Mm-hmm,
so
mm-hmm.
there might be more resources available to.
What was that again?
Those different.
Governor's plan, what?
Oh, outdoors for all. I don't know if it was a executive order or a part of the governor's priorities around the same time as the 30 by 30 conservation goals. And it was like equitable access and investments in parks and open space areas.
Nice.
I think there was a strategy document put out around that last year.
Good to check out. I'll check that out.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
Okay, should we start wrapping this item up for tonight, and then put it as a recurring item on the future agendas.
Are there any others that anybody wants to talk about tonight, or do you want it, you can take it home and read it at your leisure?
I just have a quick question on one of them, just trying to find it again. But I wrote down PEP 1.